Welcome to the third and final Film Studies Bridging session. Today we're going to be focusing on spectatorship. If the two previous sessions focused on visual literacy and emphasised how much film has in common with English language, English literature, media studies, art, photography, then today it's more about the sociology and psychology of why people watch films and what happens to them when they do so. First things first, a spectator is just a member of the audience. When you're watching a film or TV show, you're a spectator. Spectatorship theory, therefore, just explores what happens when you watch, and it covers all sorts of the complexities of that process. It takes into consideration the way different circumstances, different contextual factors, such as gender, age, ethnicity, where you're watching, who you're watching with, have some kind of impact on the viewing experience. It considers, too, the way spectators are manipulated by filmmakers, asking the question, are we just puppets in the hands of the directors, with our responses manipulated and controlled by the sights and sounds that prompt us to feel excitement or tension or joy or whatever? Or do we have the ability to override that and think for ourselves, actively negotiating how we react, respond, think and feel? Spectatorship also covers the social uses of film, exploring the reasons why people are so obsessed with film and TV culture, unpacking the social functions moving images serve. It explores how immersion in film is generated, what techniques allow us to forget our everyday lives and enter the world of the film. Specific theories include cognitive theory, Stuart Hall's audience theory, passive and active spectatorship. This session will focus on one set of ideas in particular, Murray Smith's notion of alignment and allegiance. Murray Smith's theory of alignment and allegiance talks about the way a spectator's relationship with a character is crucial to our emotional response. If we bonded with a character, then we care about what happens to them, we become tense and fearful when they're in danger, upset and saddened when they face emotional turmoil, etc. We identify with them, we relate to them, we connect to them. A number of useful terms relate to this topic. Alignment means we follow a character on their journey. Allegiance means that we feel like we're on their side. Identification occurs if we feel there is a degree of connection with that character. Smith suggested that alignment and allegiance matter for two principal reasons. If we're connected with characters and we're rooting for them, backing them, then we're going to find the film a more emotionally satisfying experience. If we care about a character, then their victories mean something, their pain affects us, and any risks they face unsettle us. But secondly, alignment is going to make watching the film much more involving and exciting. If we feel connected, then instead of viewing the film in a distant, removed way, we're going to feel more immersed in it. But surely there's a problem here. How are we supposed to relate to characters with whom we've got nothing in common? How can we align ourselves with a character whose background is very different from our own? Where's the common ground? Well, first of all, as human beings, we're highly empathetic, connecting and relating to universal emotions, thought processes, hopes and fears. But also, filmmakers use techniques that make connecting with characters seem automatic. Let's take a look.
A manifest destiny. Last edge of the city. Man, two steps further. you'd be drinking that filthy salt water. But we built these ships, dredged these canals, into San Francisco they never knew existed.
Right then, let's put our money where our mouth is, and let's put these ideas to the test. Let's take a film that would appear to pose significant problems when it comes to alignment and allegiance. Let's take the opening scene of Gladiator. So in this scene, we're introduced to Maximus, played by Russell Crowe. Maximus is a Roman general, which you aren't, a great warrior, which you're probably not, and Maximus has left his farm and his family to fight for the Empire. So in theory, in principle, it should be very difficult for us to relate to someone like that. So Ridley Scott, the director, has to pull out all the stops here. Let's have a look at some of the filmmaking decisions he makes in order to produce alignment. As you watch, and you're welcome to note things down as you do, even watch the sequence through a couple of times, consider what techniques are used to present Maximus as someone who we can like, even though he's played by Russell Crowe, respect, relate to, and align ourselves with.
Thank you. still nothing?
Not a sign.
How long has he been gone?
Nearly 2 hours. Will they fight, sir?
We shall know soon enough.
Alignment with Maximus is constructed in just 3 short minutes, which is often the way with films where connection with the protagonist is essential to the impact of the story. Ridley Scott achieves this in many ways. 1. Maximus is introduced as a gentle, sensitive soul who would rather be tending his crops than fighting. The wedding ring is central in the shot, linking it to ideas of commitment, love and family. The echoing sound of children's laughter on the soundtrack adds to that impression. 2. Hang on a minute, the cornfield is a memory. Maximus is thinking back, full of nostalgic longing for the simpler life he's left behind. So, we know he'd rather be there. He's got dreams that don't involve slaughtering barbarians. And, more importantly, we've started the film inside Maximus's head, encouraging alignment as we know how he thinks and what he longs for. Close-ups also tell the spectator that this man's thoughts and emotions are the ones we should be keyed into. 3. A point-of-view shot. We see through Maximus's eyes, and he likes nature, not just swords, so he can't be all bad. As the robin flies away, Maximus smiles, envious of the bird's freedom. The implication here is that he's trapped in his role as gruff Roman war machine. He'd rather be anywhere else but here. 4. Tracking shots allow us to move with Maximus. We're integrated into his journey as he treks through the grim story world. That shared momentum creates a great deal of connection. 5. He smiles at his troops and his troops smile back. It's a lot easier to have alignment and allegiance for someone who is liked and respected by others. So, 3 minutes and Maximus has been presented as someone likeable, with relatable hopes and dreams. Here, says the film, is a bold, heroic figure who it'll be quite empowering to pretend to be, but also a figure who's human enough to identify with. Now, when events place Maximus in difficult and tragic circumstances, we'll care. We've just scratched the surface of spectatorship in this video lesson, but hopefully it's provided some insight into another way of looking at film. The wide variety of ways you can explore and analyse films means that our students find it an extremely rewarding, exciting and interesting subject. They feel it connects very well with their other subjects because it has so many facets to it, so many dimensions to explore. It's never dull, it's fast moving, it's challenging and dynamic. If you want to find out more, visit our film website that you can access from the QE website. I hope you've enjoyed your virtual bridging experience. I'm very confident you'd enjoy the subject if you elected to take it in September. Until then, have a very relaxing summer. Take care and hopefully see you soon.